been pleased to have back with me Martin Cannon, faculty member of the celebrated Juilliard School and artist in residence at the State University of New York at Stony Brook.
That's correct.
And Teachers College faculty, where many people that I know have studied with you. Mm-hmm. In fact, there are many people that will not play in New York until they play for you, and I know that for sure.
You're too kind, David.
And you're too busy, probably, right? So thank you for coming again to discuss the Etudes. And I think we ended with Opus 10, number 10. Opus 25, right? The B minor octave etude, and this was legato octaves.
Legato octaves, that's the particular specialty of the Chopin study. That involves, I should have mentioned that last night, a good deal of in and out motions of the arm going from black notes to white notes, which is one additional problem along with 100 others that piece possesses.
This is a work that certainly requires a great virtuosity and beautiful singing tone in the section in B major, the middle section. In fact, this is one of the few etudes with a middle section, isn't it?
I was thinking just that point, David. Only the E minor,
right,
mm-hmm, and the B minor etudes are in a conventional ABA form, a clearly delineated form like that.
How about hearing someone that's not noted for a Chopin playing in this tumultuous work, Paul Badura-Skoda.
Good.
Badura Skoda playing the B minor octave etude, and Martin, I don't think he scratched the surface of the work.
It, I found it rather a tame-sounding performance, and even in the lyrical middle section, not entirely convincing in phrasing and sound.
Inflection of the beautiful, luscious melody. Well, we have played on this these etude programs many a pianist. Bachhaus, Badura Skoda, who else? Ashkenazi, Novais,
Slobodianic, Browning,
Courtauld, Browning, Pollini,
Levine.
So, obviously, these etudes are very much in the living repertory and in the recorded one. And we have a new pianist joining this illustrious company, Anton Querti. Let's hear him do the octave etude.
Thank you.
Anton Querti in the octave etude in B minor. Well, Martin, what's your comment on that performance?
I liked outer sections. I found, again, one of my, I guess by now, standard complaints that the slow lyrical middle section was, for my feeling, quite a bit too slow.
Let's move to another performance then, and one that the middle section will probably more suit you, and that's, of course, Alfred Cortot. And that was Alfred Cortot in the B minor etude. Well, did the middle section please you more?
Yes, I would like to combine Querti's opening section and closing section with Cortot's middle section. I think the perhaps I didn't say enough about the Querti that we heard before. I think it was in many ways a very beautiful performance, beautiful sound, and beautifully sensitive. Only, as I said, too slow. But Cortot, of course, is not the technical master that many of the others are, and this performance is saved only by a very lovely, if perhaps overly romantic to our present taste, middle section.
Well, it's a luscious key B major, and he can't resist.
That's right.
And he touches the heart. Well, the next one, the next pianist. Can we really call Levine a pianist? He was more. In 1889, when Levine was 14, Anton Rubinstein came to hear the pupils of the Moscow Conservatory play. Levine was last. after Rachmaninoff and Scriabin.
That was a good crop, David.
What a year. Rubinstein kept him at the keyboard for a full hour. Bravo, he cried, as the big red-headed boy played Chopin's B minor etude. You will be a great man, Rubinstein uttered. Later, this work became one of Levine's specialties. Joseph Hoffman called it the most colossal octave playing I have ever heard.
Well, praise from that source is not to be taken lightly.
This was recorded June 10th, 1935. Let's hear the octave etude, Joseph Levine. It's laughable. We've heard four performances, this being, in my opinion, Martin, quite superior.
Supreme, I would say. It would be hard to think of the outer section being played any more thrillingly, or the middle section being played any more lovingly, sensitively, perhaps a little more to modern taste than the quarto, don't you think, David? That Levine is somehow perhaps a little more reserved in temperament quarto, but he keeps the line just purer.
Beautiful middle section, the finest middle section also we've heard, and he lets the music speak for itself. He's listening.
Yes.
And he was one of the great ones. And
you know, may I just say the impression I have of someone like Levine, who played probably just a few of the etudes in public, but the ones he plays, he's so identified with. That piece is so full of, that performance is so full of marvelous details, things that must have come over a period of time, that again shows the advantage of not spreading oneself too thin, not trying to do everything, but trying to do certain things supremely well, and I think that's an example of that.
Yes, the romantic pianist, trained in the late 19th century, he was taught to make things supreme, not worry about, do you know four scherzi or all four ballades. We have a craze for the completeness. We have recitals full of the 24 preludes,
yes,
or the 24 etudes, the four ballades, and one loses a great deal on that, I think. Well, have you heard the Lazar Berman performance of the octave etude?
No, I haven't, and I would, like to.
Very curious for your opinion. Lazar Behrman in the 10th etude in B minor, Martin Cannon.
That was a thrilling performance, David. The tempo considerably faster than any of the others, and played with enormous elan and dramatic power. I thought that was really quite extraordinary.
Quite extraordinary. We will return Martin Cannon, and if it suits you, we will continue and leave the B minor etude alone and continue with the Winter Wind etude.
We get to an easy one now, right?
An easy one. Would you describe the technical difficulties?
Stupendous. First of all, the left hand has to play very fast and strongly, as does the right hand in this piece. And then it is an etude that is constantly moving between the weak fingers and the strong fingers of the hand. So there's a constant kind of test of strength and equality between the stronger and weaker fingers.
And what an exquisite work it is, and the pianistic layout just making this Winter Wind happen. It's
a cataclysmic.
It's a masterwork,
piece,
of course.
It's an absolute masterpiece.
We have a performance by a new pianist on the program, Michael Ponti. Thank you. That was from a live performance in Hong Kong by Michael Ponti of the Winter Wind Etude. Frankly, I didn't like it. I thought it was nerve-wracking, accents that seemed not to have any purpose.
Yes, there was something a little artificial, I felt, in the timing, that those big retards at the beginning of the... There's a certain rhetoric in the piece, but I think that somehow he lays it on a little too thick, let's say.
Mm-hmm. Atmosphere certainly lacking. How about Vladimir Ashkenazy?
Good.
Ashkenazy in the Winter Wind. You know, that's one of the few works that Chopin himself uses, writes a scale out. Scale is integral to the technique of piano playing, and yet so seldom will he use it. Of course, during his time, the minor composers just threw scales everywhere. Right. He must have been totally sick of them.
Right. Especially in the etudes, I think there's hardly an actual scale in mm-hmm. its original form such as this.
Well, that was Ashkenazi, and
it was all right. Supremely competent. Mm-hmm. That's harsh words for a great artist, but I suppose that's one of the either advantages or disadvantages of sitting here and listening to one great artist after another. You do realize that the really supreme performances don't come along all the time.
By no means, and I think we might have a supreme performance of this by Joseph Levine, recorded June 10th, 1935. Joseph Levine in The Winter Wind. Martin Cannon?
Colossal.
Yeah, really. Well, this is a recording that I think everyone should have. It's a Victrola mono, meaning it's RCA, VIC, 1544, with very, very sympathetic liner notes by Edmund Morris. Well, time is a-movin', and the last etude in Opus 25 coming up. called The Ocean, another title Chopin did not give it. And what's the technical difficulty here?
Well, of course, this is a study in arpeggio playing. The problem is the problem of not arpeggios where the thumb goes under, but just playing consecutive chords up the piano, up and down the piano. Therefore, the fifth finger and the thumb, which come directly next to each other, have to be equal. And there's a considerable problem of endurance. I would say it's not perhaps one of the hardest etudes, because the basic pattern lies
right
under the hand very well for a pianist. But it's hard to make it truly surging and truly monumental, as it must be.
It is certainly an effective work.
Oh, yes.
The Ocean Etude, and our performance by another new pianist to the group, Andre Watts. Andre Watts. Very good.
Very exciting. No complaints.
Let's have another performance, and we will hear Augustin Onyevis, The Ocean Etude.
Thank you.
Ocean Etude, hardly Chopin the dandy, right?
No, indeed. Chopin very much in a Beethovenian frame of mind, it seems to me, hurling his thunderbolts.
He ends his mighty Etudes, the Opus 25 in C minor, and that was Augustin Onyevis. And around 10 years later, he composes three new etudes for a method that was published by Moscheles and had many different contributors to it. The only etudes that have survived are these. Some people call them posthumous. They were actually published in 1840, though. And let's hear Rubinstein in the first of those in F minor. The Etude in F minor, Rubinstein. Well, Martin?
Sensitive playing, but it seems to me one could do a good deal more with that piece.
And you brought your recording of Courtauld to show us what can be done.
Well, I didn't want to say that, but why don't we hear Courtauld and
let the audience will make up their own mind,
right.
Of course.